We are starting up in Joshua 3 this week, and I'm going to go through 10. I'm going to read the whole chapter first, and then we're just because I'm copying Steve, and then we're going to read the whole chapter again next time. Steve's cool. I like Steve. And so we're going to read the whole chapter, come back, and we're going to go through about verse 10 today. It's going to be a shorter teaching. We wanted to set aside some time. Nick and I have been talking to set aside a bit of time to split up into groups and pray with one another. So we're gonna do that at the end here. I'm going to start off praying. How about that? Let's do that. Father, we love you. We thank you, God, for your word. I thank you, God, for these men, Lord, that we can get together, that you've stirred in their heart, God, to be here tonight and to want to be in your word, to find out, Lord, how you worked in the life of Joseph, how you're going to work in our life. And let's pray, Lord, that you would illuminate these scriptures. God, help me, Lord, not to be in your way, but God, use me to be a blessing to these men. Lord, we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Joshua chapter 3, and I'm going to read the whole shebang. Okay, then, everybody there? Page 247. Then Joshua rose early in the morning, and they set out from the acacia grove and came to Jordan, and all the children of Israel, he and all the children of Israel, lodged there before they crossed over. So it was after 3 days that the officers went through the camp. And they commanded the people, saying, when you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God, and the priests and the Levites bearing it, then you shall set out from your place and go after it. Yet there shall be a space between you and it, about 2,000 cubits by measure. Do not come near it, that you may know the way by which you must go, for you have not passed this way before. And Joshua said to the people, sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. And Joshua spoke to the priests, saying, take up the Ark of the Covenant and cross over before the people. So they took up the Ark of the Covenant and went before the people. And the Lord said to Joshua, this day I will begin to exalt you in the sight of all Israel, that they may know that as I was with Moses, so I will be with you. You shall command the priests to bear the Ark of the Covenant, saying, when you have come to the edge of the water of the Jordan, you shall stand in the Jordan. So Joshua said to the children of Israel, come here and hear the words of the Lord your God. And Joshua said, by this you shall know that the living God is among you, that he will without fail drive out from before you the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Hivites and the Perizzites and the Girgashites and the Amorites and the Jebusites. Behold, the Ark of the Covenant, the Lord of all the earth, is crossing over before you into the Jordan. Now, therefore, take for yourselves 12 men from the tribes of Israel, one man from every tribe, and it shall come to pass as soon as the soles of the feet of the priests who bear the Ark of the Lord, and the Lord of all the earth, shall rest in the waters of the Jordan, that the waters of the Jordan shall be cut off. The waters shall come down from upstream, and they shall stand as a heap. So it was when the people set out from their camp to cross over the Jordan, that the priests bearing the Ark of the Covenant before the people, and as those who bore the ark came to the Jordan, and the feet of the priests who bore the ark dipped in the edge of the water, for the Jordan overflows all its banks during the whole time of harvest, that the waters which came down from the upstream stood still and rose in a heap very far away at Adam, the city that is beside Zeraton. So the waters that went down into the sea of Arabah, the salt sea, failed and were cut off. And the people crossed over opposite Jericho. Then the priests who bore the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord stood firm on dry ground in the midst of the Jordan, and all Israel crossed over on dry ground until all the people had crossed completely over the Jordan. And so we start this shortly after record-wise, immediately after. We don't know necessarily how many days or not, but back in chapter 1, the Lord says within 3 days we'll be crossing over the Jordan. So here we are in chapter 3, and shortly after, in between that time, Joshua had sent spies. They'd gone. They stayed with Rahab. They hid. They came, hid till night, and then it came back out. So there's been some time that's passed here. But he had received this from the spies. Truly the Lord has delivered all the land into your hand, for indeed all the inhabitants of the country are faint-hearted because of us. And this is a good, if you're the commander of an army, this is a good thing. Okay, these guys are afraid. Okay, there's only this big river that we've got to get 2-ish million people across. And if you, this is kind of just from a geography standpoint, oh, this is not showing up well. From a geography standpoint, yikes. Well, this is the Dead Sea, the Salt Sea. Abel Shittim. Shittim. I mean, yeah, I know. It's multiple something. So, Acacia Grove is what it is. So Abel Shittim is right here. Jericho's right here on the other side. This is the Jordan River. You can hardly see it on this picture, unfortunately. You can kind of see, based on how wide this all is, that it's that the Jordan spread at times. There's the Jordan as it is now. If you see pictures of the Jordan now, it's very underwhelming. It's a little piddly river, really. But there's about 90% of the water flow of Jordan that's now diverted in some way. It's either dammed upstream and builds lakes. It's diverted for agriculture, so it only has about a 10th of the flow that it had at this point. On top of that, this is let me show you kind of a picture of back since the 20th century, they've done all these dams and all these work, so it hasn't overflowed its banks yet either. But this is kind of a picture back in 1920, roughly. And you can't really see it. But it's kind of you can kind of see that it's not a huge river, relatively small bridge going over it, not a huge river. 35, as it was overflowing, you can see it's dramatically larger all the way to the other side there. So when it overflowed, it could be up to almost a mile wide, and think of, you know, Mississippi's larger than that even so, but mile wide is a big river. That's not a small river. And it's one thing for two spies to get across a river. You hop in a canoe and kind of go down and come back the other way. And so it's not that big of a deal. But to get 2-some-odd million people and all their belongings across a river, you can imagine that. Huh. Oh, yeah, we're going to go do all this? So they're, God's got them all scared on the other side there. How are we going to get there? So you can't, to me, if you sit there and think about this, this is what so we start off in chapter 3, then Joshua rose early in the morning. Well, I got a good report. I need to pray. I need to get up. I need to pray. I need to figure out what is the Lord going to do? How are we going to do this? God said we're going to the other side. He didn't give any details about how. Are we going to walk on the water? Are we going to... We've been through the splitting thing. Is he going to do that? How's that going to work? This water is flowing. I mean, is it going to flow over us? Lord, how are we going to do this? We know you can. So Joshua wakes up early, and I think it's it is a good habit. It's a good thing. And I think the Bible has enough good about it, good to say about it, that it's a good idea to get up early in the morning and be with the Lord, and at least the first thing to be with the Lord. Whether it's, you know, if you work weird hours or whatever your morning is, but it's good to spend that time with the Lord. Psalm 5:3, my voice you shall hear in the morning, O Lord. In the morning I will direct it to you, and I will look up. Cause me to hear, Psalm 143:8, cause me to hear your loving kindness in the morning, for in you do I trust. Cause me to know the way in which I should walk, for I lift up my soul to you. And there's a lot of scriptures. I got to just poking around in the Bible about scriptures about getting up in the morning, getting up early in the morning. And there's actually a fair number. And I'm not a morning person, so I didn't like it at all. So this is for you guys, not for me. If you're not getting up by 5, sinners. It's messing. We go where Scripture takes us, and that's, you know, the reality is the Bible's pretty adamant that getting up in the morning and seeking the Lord is a good thing. So, let's do that. Let's work on that. That's something that I'm, again, setting my heart towards again. So here they are. Verse 3, then Joshua rose early in the morning. He sought the Lord. It would seem the Lord gave him a little more information at that point. And they set out from the Acacia Grove and came to the Jordan. And he and all the children of Israel lodged there before they crossed over. This is no small thing. He got up early. He prayed. He sought the Lord. Hey, let's go. 2.5 million people. 2 million people. That takes a bit of time to get to break camp, to do all that's got to be done there. And so he had to get up early to get that moving. They're maybe, I don't know, maybe half a mile, a mile away from the shore. It looks roughly, if you look on the map. So it took, you know, to get everybody together. And then they lodged near there. They still didn't lodge all that close, because as we see later, there was going to have to be about a half a mile lead time for the priests and the Levites with the ark. So it was after 3 days that the officers went through the camp, and they commanded the people, saying, when you see the Ark of the Covenant, the Lord your God, and the priests and the Levites bearing it, then you shall set out from your place and go after it. There they are sitting, waiting. They're all kind of waiting around, a bunch of people waiting for Joshua to come up with something. So Joshua sent the officers. Okay, this is what the plan is. This is what you guys look for. This is what we're going to do. I hope this is what we're going to do. So I'm thinking, it looks like God told Joshua here and when he sought him in the morning, that this is a plan. You're just going to send the Levites. Not necessarily that was going to be what was going to happen, but this is, he does tell him here in a bit, this is what I'll do. But we don't know when he gets the full details of this matter. So he's by faith walking. He's by faith leading, not necessarily knowing what the plan is. And man, this is kind of, as we lead our families, as we lead in work in some areas, as we lead in our different ministries, sometimes that's just the reality. We don't know the full situation. We don't know all the plan. We just have a bit of the details. And all right, let's rally the troops. This is what we're doing. I hope this works out. Lord, we're going to be praying. We're leaving it in your hands, Jesus. And that's kind of the way it is. Sometimes we just need to lead in the, you know, faith is not necessarily this big, huge thing. And sometimes if it's this big, huge thing, it gets to be, I don't know if I can do that. But if it's just take this next step, okay, I can take the next step. I can do the thing, this one step that's in front of me. And so that's what it was with these guys is yeah, we've got to get to the other side. I know that's the end goal, but I'm just taking a step. Hey, guys, rally the troops. We're getting ready to move. Let them know that we see the ark moving. We're moving. Just let them know. got the picks. Verse 3. Sorry, oops, not chapter 5. And they commanded the people, saying, when you see the ark of the covenant of the Lord, your God, and the priests and the Levites bearing it, then you shall set out from your place and go after it. And I think it bears mention here, bears worth mentioning here. You know, the ark is like the physical representation of the presence of the Lord here with Israel. And so that's what we should be looking for in what we're doing in life, is what where is the Lord? What is he doing? I want to go do that. Not, I'm going to go build something over here. God, I hope you come over here. I want you to bless this thing I'm doing. Come on. You know, we need to, what's the Lord doing? Where's the Lord going? There's a reality that God calls some people to be apostles. And the apostles are those who start. God has called and sent, gifted, made crazy to start. Apostles are a different breed of people. And so, but God calls them and he uses them. You think of Paul, you think of Pastor David. They're a different breed of people that are just wired a different way. And God uses them to start something new, to build something. Most of us are not wired that way. So we need to see, we need to look. Where's God working? Where are lives changing? Where are souls being saved? Let me go there. Where's the word being taught? I need to go there, get involved there. What ministry that's being, look around the church. What ministry, A, is producing fruit? And B, is the Lord calling me to? And that's a good sign in life. If, you know, one of you guys move, I mean, I'm sure you're all not going to be here. If you're looking for a ministry, that's another thing. Looking for a church to get involved in, that's, you guys are all here. You obviously know that. This is probably what brought you here, or some of you at least, is the Lord was doing something here. But that's a good pattern to follow. What is, don't go find a church necessarily that has a great rock band, or a church that's, you know, the key is the Lord working there? And this is the Lord's presence there? Okay, now I'm going to go get involved there. Life lesson. When you see God at work, saving souls and changing lives, become a part of that work. And it's not necessarily talking about a ministry proper. Is the Lord doing something in your neighborhood? Is there a Bible study going on? Is there something going on at work where there's a Bible study going on there? If the Lord's doing something, be involved in that. Be a part of that. And we should be drawn to that. Verse 4. Yet there shall be a space between you and it, about 2,000 cubits by measure, about 3,000 feet, half a mile, something like that. Do not come near it, that you may know the way by which you must go, for you have not passed this way before. How many know that you have not passed this way before? Every single day. You have not passed this way before. And I think that, to me, that's a... And there are bigger obstacles in our life. I mean, we've driven to work, we've gotten up in the morning, we've done those things before, but timeline-wise, we've not passed this way before. But there's bigger obstacles that sometimes we hit in life that it's like, that's the Jordan River. I have never passed that way before, and I don't know how I'm getting to the other side, Lord. And I don't know what that is. If some of you might be going through that now, or been through that, or going to go through that. But sometimes it's an important thing to stand back and get a perspective. I mean, God wanted Israel to stand back. There's half a mile that they got to. You're talking, remember, two some million people, huge group of people stood back a half a mile as the priests and Levites are marching with this ark, heading towards the edge of the water. what on earth? But they had to stand back. And sometimes in life we got to stand back. We got to maybe get alone. We got to get counseling. We got to stand back. I'm too close to this situation to make a wise decision. So I got to stand back. get a little perspective, get a little view on what's going on. Maybe get, man, I'm sure these guys are standing around, what, did you see him just take that step and the water was gone? What? What? They're standing back up at Adam, 3 miles away, the water stops. They might see, hold on, what's going on up there? This was a big flowing pile of water, so it had to have been heaping up quick. Who knows how far they could see? So either like, what? Do you see what is going on here? So who knows? They had to step back, and God kept them back to get a good perspective of what his plan was, because they hadn't been this way before. So they had to see, what's God going to do here? We're getting ready to step into the promised land. We've got battles to come in the promised land. How do we know he's going to lead us to a victory in those battles? Because we can stand back and watch him from a good perspective lead us through this moment in time, lead us through this seemingly, this is impossible. All these guys that are now much older, of fighting age, most of them, many of them were born in the wilderness and never saw the crossing of the Red Sea. Some of them, there's some that they were, you know, teens, little kids, something might have walked through. But most of these, a lot of these people never saw it. Were a distant memory. They've been walking around with a cloud for sure. But as we all get used to the provisions of the Lord, but what are you going to do for me now, Lord? I mean, I know your cloud's there. I know there's manna and birds every morning. Big deal. Been happening every day now for 40 years. What are you going to do now? But the fact is that the reality is many of us, we live in that kind of lifestyle where we've had, God is just blessed and blessed and blessed and blessed. And now we hit a road bump and hold on, what's going to happen now? What do we do now? Is God going to be able to handle this? But he can. But sometimes we need, if the problem's large enough, it's okay. Stand back. Get some perspective. If the situation's big enough, stand back and get some perspective. Get around some brothers. Seek counsel. Pray. Wait. It's okay to wait. Wait to see where the Lord's going, because you haven't passed this way before. Proverbs. Oh, one thing I wanted to kind of mention is that this is a snare that I found myself in a time or two. Wanting to believe the Lord is talking, wanting to believe the Lord is working in a certain area of my life, that I will too rashly, too quickly say, this is the Lord, he's called me to do this. He said, or this is the Lord, I'm going to give the Lord X, I'm going to give the Lord Y. And I get to it, man, I don't know that I probably should have counted the cost and all that before I just said, blah, now I've committed myself to something that may not even really be the Lord. So just this is part of why the patience, the standing back, the watching, when you haven't been this way before, stand back and think, count the costs, look where the Lord's really going. Proverbs 20:25, it is a snare for a man to devote rashly something as holy and afterward reconsider his vows. Just being transparent. This is, I've caught myself in this place a time or two where like, oh, was that really you, Lord? Should I have really said that this is you? You know, so it's, you know, I've been there before. I'm sure I'm alone in that. Nope. Yeah, and that's the thing about reconsidering, because it could certainly be the Lord, you know, and then we want to reconsider because our flesh, right? That's more than I want to pay, and it's more than I really want to take. So that's the thing with, I think it's very important that we as men wisely move and not rashly make decisions, but consider. Life lesson, God will lead you. But sometimes you need to stand back to see where he is going. God will lead you. In my life, there's no doubt that God has led me. Many times I've ran where he wasn't going, though. I think it is wise for us to be patient and to wait on him, to make sure we understand where he's going so that we can truly follow him. Because guess what? You haven't been this way before. Verse 5, and Joshua said to the people, sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. I think it gives us a good idea of preparing ourselves. If God's going to do something, God's got something he wants to do in your life. God's got a big diagnosis that he's allowed. He's got a big job promotion. He's got in my case right now, possibly buying a house. God's got wherever he's got you. What are you living expectantly? Are you living? Sanctify yourself. Set yourself apart. Prepare yourself. Consecrate yourself. Hallow yourself. Get yourself ready for what God's going to do. I think this should be not just every once in a while we do this. We should be daily. What's God going to do? Set aside your heart daily. Prepare your heart daily. What is God going to do? Verse 6. Then Joshua spoke to the priests, saying, take up the Ark of the Covenant and cross over before the people. So they took up the Ark of the Covenant and went before the people. And the Lord said to Joshua, this day I will begin to exalt you in the sight of all Israel, and that they may know that as I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I'm going to show the people, starting today, that I'm going to be with you. You're going to be my man. You're going to lead them. I'll be with you. And because I'll be with you, I'll be with them. You shall command the priests who bear the Ark of the Covenant, saying, when you have come to the edge of the water of the Jordan, you shall stand in the Jordan. And so I have the question here, does it, stand in the Jordan? That's what he tells them. That's what the Lord tells Joshua to tell them, to go basically walk and to stand into the Jordan. Does that mean stand where it is? To me, it almost sounds like, go in the water, as if to give them, to have them just walk, like you're going to go stand in, and then they may not have known, and then the water just down it went. So I don't know. My thought was that almost sounded like they didn't know what the Lord was going to do at that point. You're just going to go stand in the Jordan. So Joshua said to the children of Israel, come here and hear the words of the Lord your God. And Joshua said, by this you shall know that the living God is among you, that he will without fail drive out from before you the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Hivites, the Perizzites, the Girgashites, the Amorites, and the Jebusites. Behold, the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord of all the earth is crossing over the Jordan, crossing over before you into the Jordan. And I think I love how Joshua here took 7. This day I will begin to exalt you in the sight of all Israel. And Joshua said, by this you shall know that the living God is among you. He didn't point to himself. He didn't say, look what I'm doing. God's got my back. You guys with me? It wasn't about him. He didn't bring himself up at all here. And I think that's it reminded me of James 4:10, humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. That should be in conversation. That should be in business. That should be in a meeting that you're at work. Our goal isn't to exalt ourselves, to self-promote. That shouldn't be what we're trying to do. We should be humbling ourselves in the sight of the Lord, lifting Him up, encouraging others, building them up, not raising ourselves up. James 4:10. Humble thyself in the sight of the Lord. And I'm going to pray, and we're going to split up into groups and pray. Father, we love you. We thank you again, God, for your word. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you would humble us. God, that you would help us to humble ourselves. Lord, to have a right view of who we are. God, we thank you, Lord, for the lifting up you've already done in our lives. And make us useful to you. Help us, God, to follow you, to seek after you, to see where you're going and to choose to go there too. And I thank you for these men. In Jesus' name, amen.